you. One other question. I'd like to know, from the basic foundation, Rastafarian, his Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie, right now, what on the level of where we are, what can we do to help you, to help enlighten people that this is holy ground? No matter what has happened, this is holy ground, and it is holy ground, and we're very hopeful of that. What can we do to help lift his name right now?
Well, right now, the most that you could do, like already what you're doing in the work that you're doing, especially on the internet and things, is to make people more cognizant within the black community of the part that His Majesty played in the historical aspect of history, and to get people more concentrated on doing practical things like assisting in the movements out in Africa, because that is the main thing. You need certain support in the work that you're doing when it comes to certain representation on different levels. These kind of things like that, we get support in order to maintain those movements. But sometimes in order to really get to see somebody in Ethiopia, you have to really go on, maybe have to be able to concentrate, to spend on like 2-3 weeks in Addis Ababa. Okay. If you really want to get a meeting, it doesn't matter if you go submit a letter, they tell you come back tomorrow. You have to be there following it up, going to different avenues. If they block in one office, you have to go to another office and get, for instance, if they block us in the Prime Minister's office, you maybe need to get into the Foreign Ministry and make the Foreign Ministry know we have certain complaints and would like to get into the Prime Minister's office. Same time, we have to inform the African Union, making them know we're not getting leverage to the Prime Minister, whether they can facilitate through their office to get us into his office. But it takes time to do those things. And if you live in Shashamani, you have to come into Addis. When you come into Addis, it means hotel costs, movement costs, transportation costs, you know, subsistence and everything. And sometimes it'll be quite demanding. So most times when we go down, after 2-3 days, we have to run out. That is one of the main reasons why you see we get so delayed, because our finances don't allow us to do that. We still have to be working in Shashamani to maintain ourselves, to put, and security is a question in Ethiopia. It's not like here, you can't just leave your home and say you're going out for any length of time. Yes. When you come back, everything will be gone.
Yes.
You know, there is no mercy when it comes to those things there. You understand? So on these levels, and you know, getting more involved in other movements here, like you said, you asked about the Federation, to try and inspire them to be more proactive. Because though there's an organization here, Ethiopian World Federation, their backup of the movements in Ethiopia is minimal. Like the backup of the international executive in America, similarly, is minimal to the levels that we should be.
Okay.
If you really want to achieve anything, you have to be in harmony, or we have to be working in solidarity with one another. Because you know, in America, there are many opportunities to get funding and to make certain representation on a higher level. There's a lot of black organization, black representatives who could say a word, but the organization in America, like, they don't do nothing towards Africa's development. And Africa's development is crucial. You know, there's a lot of need to build more schools, to build community centers, to build urban centers, hospitals, and everything. For instance, right now we're seeking funding to complete 12 classroom structures for a school that has about 6,000-7,000 students in it. We have about 120 students per classroom. And in this day and age, we have 120 students in one classroom. It means nobody's learning anything. Mm-hmm. It's an impossible situation. But these things can be easily solved if we just, as black people, concentrate on the little practical things that we can do on the continent to assist its development. So it's those practical movements, because many years people have been talking Africa. But when it comes to the practical assistance to help at the grassroots level, it is very much lacking.
Well, thank you. And lastly, I'd like to, on this same level, I'd like to ask a question, because you've shared a lot. We appreciate, and my meeting you, and you, your sister, her husband, welcoming us into their home. We appreciate that. I'd just like to hear from you and Albert, Ross Albert, right now. This is a blessing. This is a 30-year reunion of two people who are living, are true living of the truth right now. I just like the two of you to share what meeting after 30 years, what this means right now, iron sharpeneth iron. What can we take away from this meeting, a union of you two being together right now at this point?
And everything, review everything within the context of the Father's plan.
All right, you two Rasta brothers, come together closer here.
Yeah.
It's 30 years y'all done got together.
Yeah, well, if I might just interject a bit. As a youth, you know, I first met Kabinda, I think it was in the early 80s. And since that time to now, a lot of water has gone under the bridge.
Okay.
Rastafari has matured into what it is today. Okay, from the days of the dreadlock to now, the Rasta men themselves have matured both physically in age and I would say in their intellect as well. Now, not all have matured in the same way. You know, although we come up from the same tree, but all the fruits don't mature in the same way. And what Kabinda has pointed out is that there is a need for those Rastafarians who are knowledgeable of the direction, of the agenda of Rastafari, to pick up that mantle, to do the work that needs to be done, in order that Rastas, the Rasta ideal, which has always been repatriation, can be fulfilled. Rather than being it an individual effort of just a few Adrian Seastrain on the land, that the Rastafari movement itself needs to wake up and realize that there is a movement to protect, there is an integrity to protect, that is calling for the highest level of statesmanship.
All right.
Within the movement to be realized. Now the meeting of I and I with Kabinda now after such a long time is indicative of the sort of movement Rastaman needs to do. Rastaman needs to seek out one another, you know? We need to rub shoulders a lot more often, you know. The Rastafari movement has mattered in a situation where it's almost like every man for himself. Whereas in the early days, it was more or less I and I, which meant communion, coming together, I and I, you know. Yeah. But right now, every man has seemed to just become his own king within himself. He has his king and his queen and he doesn't regard the movement, you see. So we need to re-energize the movement. The movement needs to be re-energized once again.
Okay.
So that the Rasta can fulfill its agenda and its heritage, which is the heritage of knowing that I and I are his children of his Imperial Majesty, who have been given a land by his royal charter, and we need to protect that. We need to start talking about that and start making moves, representation to our Caribbean governments, to the organized African unity, and wherever black people are in the diaspora, they need to know that the promised land is where we have to direct our energies from. So this meeting today is really a blessing to me, Kabinda. We're here today, we don't know when we'll meet again, but Jah know and Jah takes everything into account.
All right, I know you've summed it up, Ross Abbott, you know? You summed it up beautifully. But as we end this interview, tell us all, because evidently your impression of Ross Kabinda over 30 years ago was so strong. Looking at him now and looking through his struggle, looking into his fight, are you just as motivated? More so? And tell us what it is in one sentence that you want us all to just carry away from just what you see now.
Leadership qualities You know, because the reason why Rasta Bindu was persecuted back in the 70s was because of his leadership qualities.
Okay.
Because he was able to put his head above the parapet and see the light, whereas a lot of youth in his time, for his age, could not see that far into the struggle, could not analyze, you know, the colonialism that was surrounding Man and Man and crippling the growth of black people. You know, it was left to so-called intellectuals that went to university to know a little about black liberation, you see. But when you have youths coming up that definitely see the light and have the ability to transfer that to others, then you become a threat to the system, you see. And it is the system now that was responsible for all Rasta's problems, because they see Rasta coming from an angle of true liberation, of freedom for I people, you understand? And through the powers of the Most High, Rasta Bindu is able to relent against the system, has been able to you know, continue to make progress despite the oppression, you see? And being in Ethiopia today is really the pinnacle of a Rastaman's worldview, you see?
Okay.
So I would say, in a word, it's just leadership. Leadership, leadership, leadership. Rastas must respect. Rasta must mature in leadership, and Rasta must continue to forward leadership.
All right, thank you. Well, Rasta Bindu, you heard that from someone that you inspired over 30 years ago, and he's still growing strong now. We're going to end it. I'm going to turn it back over to Albert. Is there any final words that you'd like to end with?
It's one blessed Rastafari. Let us pray for everything will be better in the future, and that we can still keep our links and we can start to grow and mature so that the younger generation could take hope that I and I did not fail in our endeavors, that we were able to achieve certain things that are practical and feasible, and we will have hope to continue the struggle. Because if I and I fail, then the youth and them will have no inspiration to continue. But I and I were inspired by the works of I and I fathers before. So it is for I and I now, or this generation who come now of age, in order to still pursue and not give up despite the obstacles and tribulation that we might still face.
We thank you, Jah Rastafari.
Yes, yeah.